Hi guys, welcome back. Hi guys, welcome back to Swordwind. We are the Charlotte branch of the New York Historical Fencing Association. And in this video, we are going to be talking about the Bolognese terminology for guards. We'll be going over each of these guards in more detail in separate videos, but I thought it would be worthwhile to make a video that is just about how the Bolognese break down their guards, because unlike the KDF tradition that we also teach here at Swordwind, the Bolognese have a system rather than just a kind of a random list of metaphorical names for their guards. The Bolognese also care about their guards a lot more than KDF does. So before we launch into kind of the specifics of the various guards, here is a video kind of explaining the terminology. We're going to be restricting ourselves to guards that they use for single sword work for now. There will be a later video made for sword and buckler work, or for that matter, any sword and any kind of defensive companion arm. Because once you have a second weapon in play, there are more guards you can kind of safely employ according to the Bolognese tradition. To begin with, Bolognese basically divide their guards into three sides. You have guards that originate from your, the guards that are on your right side with the hand at or below shoulder level, guards on your center to left side, again at or below shoulder level, and guards that are above, where the hand is above the shoulder. So we can think of that kind of as high, right, and left. The anything that is in this lower right sector is going to be named Cota Longa something. Cota Longa is basically Bolognese code for in your lower right. The name Cota Longa means long tail. It doesn't seem to refer to actual to an actual anatomical tail. The Anonimo Bolognese actually calls out the fact that there are Cota Longa guards that don't look at all tail-like. I'm demonstrating one right now. Instead, according to Giovanni Dall'Agocchia, the name is a reference to an Italian proverb, which was basically, don't mess with people that have long tails. That is to say, don't mess with people who have an entourage. Because if you see somebody walking around town and they have an entourage, they have, as the proverb went on to say, many ways to harm you. Basically, don't mess with people that are important enough to have entourages, because they have lots of ways to make your life hell. Similarly, when your sword is on your right side, and I'm speaking from a right-handed perspective here, to be more neutral, I should say, when your sword is on your sword side, then it is, at least according to the Bolognese way of thinking, more ready to do more things to the enemy than, for instance, if your guard was here, or if your guard was somewhere above the shoulder, like this, for instance. Here, at least according to the Bolognese way of thinking, I can cut very easily, I can also thrust very easily, which is not necessarily the case when I'm here, or here, or here, or here. Whether or not that seems intuitive to you, this is evidently the way the Bolognese thought about it, so there's your metaphor. If your sword is on your left side, and I'm dividing the body here not down the anatomical center, but basically around the sword side leg. So this, in Bolognese terms, is left. Is your left side. This is also your left side. They don't have a specific terminology for center, nor are there specific guards that are centered as opposed to left, the way you would find in Lichtenauer's Ghost of Spectrum, for instance. Anything in your lower left sector, then, is Porta di Ferro something. Porta di Ferro is the name, the Bolognese name for lower left sector. Porta di Ferro means iron door. Again, according to the Bolognese way of thinking, this is a more secure guard than this. That is, it's harder to attack somebody in a Porta di Ferro guard because they have more options. They have more options for defense, and more of their body is covered. Because I can kind of cover myself, because Porta di Ferro refers not only to the center line but also to my left, I can hold myself like this. My blade covers my arm basically all the way up to the shoulder. The hilt covers the left side, and depending on how I angle the sword towards my opponent's face, I can even kind of cover my upper openings. This doesn't actually feel secure to all students, and if it doesn't feel secure to you, that's fine. Just know that this is, again, the Bolognese way of thinking about things. If your guard is over your shoulder, whether it's here or here, right side, left side, center, the name for that is going to be Guardia something or other. Although all of these in your lower right sector, your lower left sector, your kind of top, your kind of high sector, all of these are referred to as guards, guardia in Italian. But the name for those guards doesn't include the word guardia unless your hand is above your head. So this is Guardia Alta, this is Guardia di Alicorno, Guardia something, just because my hand is over my shoulders. For single sword work, the hand above the shoulder is kind of, the shoulder height is kind of a big deal because I can keep my point forward as long as my hand is below my shoulder, and I can keep my hand forward until my hand hits about like the, is about level with my humerus. By the time my hand is here, above my shoulder or my humerus, which is the actual anatomical marker that the Anonimo Bolognese gives, then I have to start doing things to my hand in order to bring my point forward. Why is it important to me to keep my point forward? Because I don't have another weapon, and because this is a one-handed sword. Those are related reasons, but they are two. For instance, if I had a long sword, Lichtenauer would be totally fine with me not keeping my point forward, despite the fact that I have only one weapon. The Bolognese, however, when you don't have a companion weapon, that is, when you like to keep their points forward, they consider it safer than withdrawing the point, even though that does rob you of some cutting capacity, as we'll discuss in later videos about specific guards. So, moming on to terminology. We have Coda Longa, Porta di Ferro, Guardia. Then we have another word we can add on to those, which also specifies something about our hand position. Stretta means have the hand straight and extended down toward close to the knee. So this is Porta di Ferro stretta. This is Coda Longa stretta. This is Porta di Ferro stretta. The word stretta means, it means close, it means narrow, it means secure, it means tight. By keeping my hand close to my knee, I am doing all of those things. I'm keeping my sword close to me. I'm also, there's a very narrow slice of my body that is not, that is exposed here. Whereas if I were to hold my hand further out, my hand is exposed, my forearm is exposed to attacks coming this way. Here, not so much. So stretta is Bolognese for hand towards the knee, point forward. Point forward is important because if I were here, even though my hand is by my knee, of course, my hand is in fact still open. And going off of the meaning of stretta, the connotation of stretta that means secure, or safe, this isn't nearly as safe to me as keeping my point towards the opponent. So we've got Streta on the Covadonga side, also on the Puerto de Ferro side. Streta is not something that we're going to add into the Guardia sector. In fact, the Guardia sector really only has is less systematic in its names than the Covadonga and the Puerto de Ferro side. Instead of Streta, my guard could be Larga. This is Covadonga Larga. This is Puerto de Ferro Larga. Larga is Bolognese for hand towards the knee, but the point is towards the ground. So here I am threatening with the edge. This is the sort of motion I'm likely to make from here. At least not immediately with the point. Larga means wide. Larga is the opposite of Streta. It means wide, it means loose, it means open. You can see how this is a much more open guard than this is. This is more open than this. There's Larga. The last kind of bit of guard options we have here is Alta. Alta is Italian for high. When applied to Covadonga or to the Puerto de Ferro side, alta means high in the sense that the hand is not above the humerus. So I can get to about here, and my hand is in line with my humerus. It's a tiny, tiny bit lower than my shoulder. So this is Covadonga alta, this is Puerto de Ferro alta. This is not obviously as high as my hand can go. This is Guardia alta, which is in fact the highest that my sword can go. So we've got, start to see now how how we can name guards by kind of stringing these variables together. I can be in Covadonga something, and if I am told to go into Covadonga larga, then I know to do this. If I'm told to go into Puerto de Ferro Streta, then I know if my hand needs to be on this side of my body, it needs to be close to the knee, and the point needs to be forward. Notice, by the way, going back to Alta, that in order to bring my hand in line with my humerus, my hand also needs to go forward. The only other way to do that would be something like this. Hopefully the structural deficiencies of this kind of guard are obvious. As a general rule, Bolognese keep their arms extended all the time. There are occasions when you break that, but this is explicitly given in our texts as a rule that you should follow. Keep your arms extended, whether your hand is here, which will obviously extend your hand further towards your opponent, or here, arms extended, none of this nonsense. Arms extended, arms extended, arms extended, and so forth. That is the way that Bolognese terminology breaks down. I'm either Covadonga something, Puerto de Ferro something, or Guardia something, and then I am either Streta, Larga, Alta, or if I am up here, in my Guardia sector, there will be a special name. We've got Guardia Alta, Guardia di Alicorno, Guardia Testa, Guardia di Testa, I should say, Guardia di Faccia, Guardia di Entrare, Guardia di Entrare. As I said, those are less systematized. We're going to get into what those mean in separate videos. For now, I hope this has been helpful for students as they kind of try to learn what all this terminology means. Before we go, a note on learning terminology and kind of studying guards according to the Bolognese way of thinking. As with any historical European martial art, it's important to learn the original terminology, at least to the extent that kind of modern practitioners tend to use it. If you meet a fencer from somewhere outside your school and you want to talk about Bolognese terminology, then it's important to know that most modern Bolognese fences are going to refer to this as coda longa stretta and not, for instance, narrow long tail. So that if somebody says coda longa stretta to you, you're able to communicate with them about your art. It's also interesting, I think, that Morasso, in his second book, has a section on what all the guards are, and then a digression directed to the putative teacher of Bolognese swordsmanship, where he says, basically, it's a real shame that people don't study the guards for their own sake anymore. And the thing that he, the reason he gives for that is that there are plenty of, allegedly, plenty of fencing masters in his day who produce fencers who are good fighters, but are not good instructors. Morasso, throughout his book, is deeply concerned with passing on, kind of preserving the legacy of this art. He's writing in the 1530s, which is kind of right on the cusp of when the military revolution was really going to start changing the way people fought in Italy. And I think he probably saw, as later Renaissance fencing masters throughout the 16th century definitely saw, that these arts were going to start dying off. Obviously they did not, in fact, die off. Historical European martial arts continued to be relevant, kind of living, basically up until World War I. But he's concerned that people who basically only know how to fight and don't study their guards, who don't think about these things and learn the system behind the way they've been taught to fight, are not going to be able to teach people, are not going to be able to pass on the tradition. Since European swordsmanship did basically die off for us, and we are very much concerned with being able to teach this stuff, I think it's worth remembering Morasso's words and the concerns that he had 500 years ago, that studying these things is not just a way to help learn for your own fencing, but it's important for your ability to pass on the tradition to others. So I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'll see you next week with another video.